It's incredible news, Davina. It's really news that no one expected after 47 hours lost in these freezing conditions here in the bushland. Will Callaghan has been found. And right behind me, as you can probably see, there's quite a large gathering of people because it really wasn't that long ago that he was found. Only seconds ago was he driven in here in a car by his mum and his stepdad, dropped off, and he's currently being treated by paramedics. We didn't get a glimpse at Will's face. He was covered in a puffer jacket. He had a hoodie on, and understandably overwhelmed by what's unfolded here. The Ambos came over to us just a second ago to say, please, no clapping, no screaming, no cheering. We're all exceptionally happy, but please don't respond like that. We've got to keep it as calm as possible as we can for little Will. Now, we don't exactly know where he was found at this stage. As I've just told you, the details are only now filtering in, but there was a bit of an air of excitement here. About 20 minutes ago, there were whispers that the police chopper had spotted him and they believed that he was alive and well, but they didn't want to scare him. They called the parents in. We saw the stepdad run to his car, and within seconds, confirmation that he was alive, he was breathing, and he was conscious. We're not entirely sure whether he's sustained any other physical injuries. Obviously, he's been missing for 47 hours, two extremely long nights lost in these freezing conditions on both nights. It hit 0 degrees, but actually felt like a lot less than that. It's exceptionally dense terrain here as well. So we've got a lot of regrowth from the bushfires on Black Saturday, and that may have actually helped Will in terms of keeping him warm. A lot of the searchers that we've spoken to here today and over the last few days, Davina, have said that they were hoping he may have found a log or bush to hide under if he hadn't actually made it to the urban landscape. And it seems that's what's happened, because between that moment that we found out that he was there, he was in the bush, and Dad running out there, it was probably only 10 minutes before the car came right back here. The sense here, the vibe from the community is just incredible. Everyone is so overwhelmed. I don't think anyone expected this feeling. And we're all just so excited to see what Will is like and what his family have to say.
Lana, we're watching live pictures from the news helicopter above you at the moment that gives us a sense of the command post there, the Salvation Army. We're looking at pictures of a tent there at the moment. It appears as if the SES has put up some barriers around an area possibly where they're looking at Will at the moment, treating him, because he has spent two nights out in bushland where the temperatures plunged to 0 degrees. There were concerns that he didn't have shoes on because he doesn't like wearing shoes. He might have been barefoot. And his parents described how he was just simply wearing a thin tracksuit pants, so that not a lot of warmth considering he is such a tiny boy.
Yeah, the big fear here was that he would have hypothermia. As I mentioned, it was absolutely freezing over this last 47 hours. And when he went missing, it was around 2 o'clock on Monday afternoon. He was just out here for a stroll with his dad and his other brother. He was only wearing a thin tracksuit. He was wearing a hoodie, a long sleeve top and tracksuit pants. And Penny, his mum, spoke to us not that long ago and said he doesn't like wearing shoes. So it's pretty likely that he may have actually taken them off. And he's also very energetic. He's a runner, so, and he loves nature. So it was very likely that he would have stripped those shoes off, run into the bush and found somewhere to stay. So the real fear was that he would be freezing, he'd contract hypothermia. Obviously that is now exactly what they're looking at and trying to take care of him and make sure he's okay.
Lana, this was a search unlike anything we've ever seen before, because William does have autism. Mm. He's non-verbal. SES and police, they couldn't use noise to bring him out. They couldn't call out to him because he couldn't respond. So they had quite a number of ingenious ways, hoping that they would be able to lure him out of the bushland if he could hear them. Talk to us about the scale of this operation and the uniqueness in which police and SES had to use to try and find this boy.
Yeah, absolutely. I've never seen something to this scale, and also the really different techniques that they've used. One of the most interesting would be the PA systems that they've put out here in the bushland. They've got three separate PA systems on Mount Disappointment playing songs from Thomas the Tank Engine. So that's Will's favourite show. He loves the music from that show. We were told in the last few days if anyone, any of the searchers that were on foot had phones that they could play music out of, that would be great. Well, it stepped up a level today. So we've had police cars stars up on the top of the mountain near the summit where Will was last seen playing that music and trying to kind of lure him in. But there are a couple of other things. So Penny, Will's mum, told us that he loves food and he's very food oriented, and so they were concerned that he may have run to an urban landscape. There are some farmhouses around here and a couple of other, you know, regional areas if you go a few kilometres away from the mountain. And so they were asking people to cook a barbecue. He was attracted to the smell of bacon and onion, we were told. So if people were able to put the barbecue on, start cooking some food there and maybe attract him that way. If that wasn't going to work, they asked everyone to put out some water so that if he came along and he wasn't comfortable to reach out, he'd still have something to drink. And also put out some Vegemite and feta cheese on the veranda. So there were plenty of options if he needed a little bite to eat.
It was really a call to local residents in that area as well, wasn't it, Lana? Not just to do all those things, but just to get out there and help search. And it touched so many people, so much so they had to turn volunteers away.
Yesterday was incredible. There was such a surge of community spirit here. I've really never seen anything like it before. It got to the point at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon where there were packs of people turning up. They were ready, they had their backpacks on, they had their hiking boots on, and the police actually did have to say, sorry, we've already got 450 of you here, we can't cope with any more. And what a brilliant problem to have. We've had, you know, mums and dads with their family dog just coming for a stroll to see if they can help. We've had the footy team, we've got an AFL W player was here today, Taylor Harris, just contributing to the search. We've had Uncle Nev's, the local ranch, bringing their horses here so everyone could just kind of explore on horseback. And that's on top of the incredible search effort that's been organised by police and, of course, the SES here. We've had about 250 official members here with their boots on the ground. The police have had officers on horseback, on motorbike. They've had the dog squad. And there's also been some extra special trained Labradors out in the bush as well, having a sniff around. So really, there was literally no stone left unturned.
Well, Lana, we are waiting for those extraordinary pictures to come into our newsroom of the moment he was reunited, Will Callaghan reunited with his family. We do have a picture that has just come into our newsroom. That's a picture of Will. I'm just waiting to hear official word if that's just from... this picture was taken just after he was found this morning, this afternoon, so 10, 15 minutes ago, and I guess the relief that so many people would love to see that photo to know that he is looking happy and healthy and okay. And the big concern was that after 3 days stuck in bushland, lost, unable to speak, that he could be in a difficult situation. But by the looks of that photo with a blanket wrapped around him and some happy eyes and a bit of a smile on his face, he looks like he's doing well. Lana, the mood there on the ground, talk to me about it, because as you said, people can't cheer, they can't clap, they can't applaud. This is the moment they've been waiting for, but they can't make too much noise because that could upset Will.
Yeah, it's kind of bizarre, isn't it? Because that is our natural reaction. All of us just want to kind of put our hands up and go, yay, congratulations. There's certainly been quite a few hugs here at the campsite. People are really, really excited, but they're trying their best to keep it to themselves. As I said, the ambulance officer actually came up to us, said, please, no clapping, no cheering. We're just going to keep it as calm as physically possible around here. And I can actually see that it's already dispersing. There's actually quite a few vehicles that are driving out back from that campground there with they were just basing themselves behind the trees. We can see that the tarp is actually now down as well where they were treating Will. So I'm going to take a guess and think that he may actually be in the back of that ambulance now. But I'll go over and have a walk in a second. But yeah, you can see all these cars, they're leaving now. There's nothing more for them to do. They've got Will, he's home. Everyone's happy.
Lana, stay with us. Go for a little wander and see what you can find out. We'll just recap on what we know. So in the last 20 minutes, we've got word that William Callaghan, the 14-year-old who has been missing at Mount Disappointment, north of Melbourne for the last 3 days, has been found alive, safe and well, and has been reunited with his family. You're looking at live pictures coming into our newsroom above that search site where it is incredible dense bushland. It has been very cold. It's dipping below freezing last night to -3 degrees, zero the night before. So he spent 2 nights out in that terrain. And by all reports, by the picture you've just seen on your screen, he is very well, very happy, and no doubt very thankful to be back in mum and dad's arms. They have had in excess of 500 people on the ground there looking for William. SES, police and volunteers, so many that they've actually had to turn them around over the last few days because there have been too many people on the ground. But I guess the relief that we've seen in those pictures, those live pictures coming in, people hugging, thankful that he has been found alive. As Lana mentioned, he suffers from autism. He's also non-verbal, so he had a very sensory overload if there's too much noise, if there's too much compounding the situation. So they have to be relatively quiet at the site there at the moment. But that is what made the search for William so difficult over the last 3 days, because it didn't matter how much the SES and police called out to Will, they knew that he wouldn't be able to respond to them. Earlier this morning, we heard from Penny, Will's mum, who was optimistic. She was hoping for this outcome, but understandably, 2 nights without her boy, and she was very nervous. Take a listen to what she shared with us earlier this morning.
He's such a beautiful person. He wouldn't harm a fly. He's very gentle. I think you're all wondering what to do to help. I guess, you know, if he has reached the urban environment at this point, he will look out of place. He'll be quite scared of loud noises, and he's wearing navy blue. I'm hoping he still has his clothes on. He may be barefoot though. He doesn't like shoes. He will, you know, probably be covering, covering his ears a fair bit if there is loud noise. Will is loved by everyone who comes across him. I have three different schools involved here who are supporting us. Mansfield Autism Statewide Services are awesome, and they are here helping.
Penny certainly provided lots of support from the community, but 2 nights without her boy and concerns about his welfare. So live pictures coming in right now to our newsroom of the reunion. Will being checked by paramedics on the ground there at the moment. We know he has been reunited with his parents, and he does have a younger brother as well who also suffers autism. So the incredible pain and agony that family must have faced in the last 48 hours. He disappeared at 2:20 on Monday afternoon on the public holiday. He was with his dad at the time and wandered away from the group, disappeared into the thick bushland, and there was no trace of him since. What we have seen since then is the most extraordinary search and rescue operation by crews on the ground who couldn't use noise to try and find him. They couldn't call out to him, and they knew that no matter how much noise they made, he wouldn't be able to call back out to them. So what they have used on the ground is a number of sensory techniques to try and find William. They knew that he loved Thomas the Tank Engine, so they were playing the theme song for the TV show as loud as they possibly could on speakers. We know that SES crews and volunteers on the ground were playing it on their mobile phones, hoping that Will could hear that and would come out of the bushland. They were also using scents and smells, so they were asking locals in the area to cook onion and barbecue and bacon on their barbecues today, hoping that smell might lure Will out because he loves those smells. Also, Vegemite on toast, feta cheese. Residents in the area were asked to leave those things out on their bench, out on their verandas, open the doors and open the windows if they were cooking today, any sort of sense of smell to lure him out, because as his mum explained, he's a 14-year-old boy, he has a huge appetite, he loves food. He's also very tiny, and that would have been quite a concern for emergency crews on the ground. He was only dressed in quite a thin hoodie at the time and thin tracksuit pants. Another concern with his sensory issues was that he doesn't like to wear shoes, and there were major concerns that he might have been barefoot. But the information we are getting this afternoon is that he is safe and well. He was found about 20 minutes ago, our understanding, about half an hour ago now. And from the picture that we came into our newsroom that I understand was taken just moments after he was found, he is looking well, bright-eyed, with a blanket around him, a bit of a smile on his face, and certainly very happy, healthy eyes. So the pictures at the moment, live pictures from the command station, that's the picture that came into our newsroom just moments ago that we understand was taken just moments after he was found. He's now back in the arms of his family, his younger brother who also suffers autism, his mum, his stepmum, and no doubt his dad, who was the last person to see him, all very thankful to know he's safe and well. Police were optimistic. They were hopeful that they would get a happy end to this story, but they were also realistic. 2 nights stuck in bushland. And it was cold weather, and it was unfamiliar territory. It was always going to be a difficult challenge to find anyone who was lost in bushland. It was also complicated by the fact that this is bushland that has had a fire recently burned through it, and the vegetation that has grown back is very dense and very thick. And Lana Murphy, our reporter, who we were just speaking to, actually went out with the search crews earlier this morning, and she mentioned how thick it was, so much so she actually had to turn around and come back because that's how dense the bushland is. Lana is standing by for us. She's gone for a wander to speak to the crews on the ground there to hear any more word. Lana, what are you hearing about this very happy reunion?
Tavina, I literally just walked over and it's an incredible story. There was a lone bushman who was walking not too far from here in the bush and he saw Will. There he was, standing and smiling. He walked up to him. He was calm. He was gentle. He offered him some food. Will took the food. Bushman made the call. Will is now back in the arms of his mum and dad. So right behind me here, where they're holding up this tarp, you can probably see the SES members. That is exactly where Will is right now. He's still being treated by paramedics. His mum and stepdad arrived in that patrol car right there and brought him home. And we're not too far away from speaking to the lovely bushman that actually made this brilliant discovery that a lot of us
Lana, you stay there because we do have those pictures that have just come into our newsroom of the moment he was reunited with his mum. There you can see a Penny there, a holding Will, wrapped up tight in that hoodie. I think that is his stepdad that's carrying him there into the tent so that he can be checked by paramedics. As we were told, he is a smaller 14-year-old boy, so there were very serious concerns about how he would weather two nights stuck in bushland, carried there by his stepdad. So obviously some concerns that he also hasn't had food for 48 hours and what sort of condition he would be in. But as a mum, you wouldn't want to let go of your boy after he's been missing for 48 hours. And I can only imagine Penny's emotion there where she finally got to hold him. Lana is still standing by for us, I hope, because you've got more details on this bushman who found Will alive. We'll keep watching these pictures, Lana. They're the pictures everyone's been waiting to see for the last 48 hours. Tell us more about the man who found him.
All we know at this stage, Davina, is he was completely on his own, which is quite unusual because everyone that's been taking part in this bush search in the last 47 hours has really been walking in groups. My understanding is that he's not part of the bush search and rescue, he's not part of the SES. He was just a community volunteer that's come here to try and pitch in. He's gone for a walk and he's made that discovery that absolutely everyone was hoping for. I think something that's probably a little bit surprising is that Will wasn't cowering away like a lot of us probably expected. His family told us that they were hoping that he was hidden under a log or under some bush to try and keep warm, but he was just standing there right in front of the bushman. He arrived not too long after Will was reunited with his family and he simply told us, "I just hope my daughter is proud of me."
Oh, I think all of Australia's proud of him at the moment to know that he's brought a happy end to a story that we've been watching for the last 48 hours. There were real serious concerns, weren't there, Lara? Alana, I know we were told that optimistically police were hoping for a good outcome here, but realistically they knew they were up against it. A little boy who wasn't going to respond to them. Two nights stuck, lost in bushland where it's cold, no food. They were nervous about this.
Oh, of course they were. The real concern was obviously that he would contract some sort of hypothermia. And the problem here was there was just so many extra layers. It wasn't your standard missing person search where, you know, normally people would be heading out into the bushland. They'd been screaming someone's name. They'd been hoping that someone would hear them or call back. But as we know, Will is living with autism. He's very low functioning. He's non-verbal. He struggles with sensory processing disorder. He does not talk at all. And he really quite struggles to communicate with even those who are very close to him and love him, let alone complete strangers. And there has been a lot of noise here. We've seen lots of motorbikes from police and from community volunteers that have been going out, but that's noisy and it's aggravating. And there was a concern that it might actually scare Will further into the bushland if this was in fact where he was hiding. But by some stretch of some miracle, he hasn't been really too far from where he went missing, and he was standing there and he was calm. And thankfully, this bushman who came across him was equally as calm. He was kind and he slowly approached. He used the advice that the police had given us all along, saying, you know, Will only communicates by thumping on his chest He loves Thomas the Tank Engine music and he loves food. So that bushman really complied with those requests from Will's family and from the police and approached really calmly and slowly and has really led to this incredible, incredible result.
Lana, talk to us about Will's condition, because as we watch these pictures now of the moment he was reunited with mum and stepdad, we can see him covering his ears. It's overwhelming, a sensory overload for him at the best of times, because he doesn't speak, he doesn't like loud noise, but yet you've got no doubt a police helicopter hovering above, you've got just 500 people in that area at the moment, lots of vehicles. It was a real struggle for a little boy that at the best of times life is hard, and right now it would no doubt be very overwhelming.